हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर विकास अग्रवाल, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर स्कूल ऑफ लॉ, डॉक्टर हरिशंकर विश्वविद्यालय सागर। टुडेज टॉपिक ऑफ अवर डिस्कशन एंड लर्निंग इज ऑल अबाउट द डॉक्ट्राइन ऑफ मैंस रिया एंड एक्टस रियस। दिस चैप्टर इज डिवाइडेड इनटू द फॉलोइंग मॉड्यूल्स, दैट इज मॉड्यूल 1 इंट्रोडक्शन, मॉड्यूल 2 मीनिंग ऑफ मैंस रिया, मॉड्यूल 3 एप्लीकेशन ऑफ प्रिंसिपल ऑफ मैंस रिया टू स्टैट्यूटरी ऑफेंसेस, मॉड्यूल 4 मैंस रिया एंड इंडियन पिनल कोड, मॉड्यूल 5 Exceptions to the principle of mens rea, module 6th actus reus, and module 7th is about conclusion. So let us start with the first module, that is introduction. The essential elements necessary to constitute a crime are: first, a human being; second, a guilty intention, that is called mens rea; third, act or omission, that is called actus reus; and the fourth one is injury. The first element requires that wrongful act must be committed by a human being. In ancient times, the idea of retribution was prevailing. So, the punishment were inflicted on animals also for the injury caused by them. But now, if an animal causes an injury, we hold not the animal liable but its owner liable for such injury. The second important essential element of crime is mens rea, or evil intention or guilty intention. The human being forms a guilty intention to commit a crime, and with that guilty intention he does the act, which is the third essential element of crime, that is called actus reus. As the fundamental principle of criminal liability is that there must be a wrongful act combined with a wrongful intention, a person cannot be punished only for his act in the absence of guilty intention on his part. The fourth element of crime is injury. When by the intended act of a human being injury is caused, then the crime is complete. Injury is caused to another person or to the whole society. According to section 44 of the Indian Penal Code, the word injury denotes any harm whatever illegally caused to any person in body, mind, reputation or property. Here in this chapter, we will discuss in detail the mens rea and actus reus, which are the two most important essential elements of crime. Now we come to the second module, that is meaning of mens rea. A fundamental principle of criminal law is that a crime consists of both a mental and a physical element. Mens rea, that is a person's awareness of the fact that his or her conduct is criminal, is the mental element, and actus reus, that is the act itself, is the physical element. Mens rea is a technical term generally taken to mean some blameworthy mental condition, the absence of which on any particular occasion negatives the condition of crime. It is one of the essential ingredients of criminal liability. A criminal offense is committed only when an act which is forbidden by the law is done voluntarily. It is the main characteristic of our legal system that individual's liability to punishment for crimes depends, amongst other things, on certain mental conditions. The absence of these conditions, where they are required, negatives the liability. Therefore, an act, in order to be a crime, must be committed with a guilty mind. This principle is based on the maxim, actus non facit reum nisi mensesit rea. It means the act alone does not make a man guilty unless his intentions were so. No person can be held liable for his act unless it is proved that he had a guilty mind. It is a combination of act and intent which makes a crime. In the case of Sweet versus Parsley, Lord Diplock said, "An act does not make a man guilty of a crime unless his mind be also guilty." Samand said that the responsibility in crimes must depend on doing of a willed or voluntary act and a particular intent behind that act. For any criminal liability, there must be a voluntary act. This proposition is derived from the maxim, actus me in vito, factus non est mens actus, which means an act done by me against my will is not my act. This maxim supports the doctrine of mens rea, for no person can be held liable for an act done under fear or compulsion. For example, A holds B and compels him at gunpoint to open the lock of C's house. Here, B's act is not a willed or intentional act. Now, we will discuss the origin and development of mens rea. Notion of mens rea in early primitive societies was non-existent, and the liability was absolute and the offenders were responsible whether he acted innocently or negligently. In the earlier times, the trials were held on the fundamental presumption that a man must almost in every case be deemed to have intended to do what he had done. In those days, the distinction between crime and tort was not clearly drawn, and punishment in those days mainly consisted of money compensation to the person wronged. Therefore, the mental attitude of a person was an irrelevant consideration. But later on, bodily punishment came as a substitute of the payment of damages. It was then that the importance of mens rea at the time of commission of the crime was realized. With the passage of time, the requirement of mens rea as an essential element of crime has firmly taken its root. Before the 13th century, the doctrine of mens rea was almost non-existent. Even then, it was not completely disregarded and was kept in view in awarding the punishment. But by the end of 17th century, it was universally settled law that mens rea is an essential ingredient of crime. Now we come to the third module, that is application of principle of mens rea to statutory offences. The principle of mens rea has been applied to all common law offences in England without any exception. But the answer to the question that whether it is applicable to statutory offences was uncertain up to 1947. The question whether the common law requirement of mens rea must be imported into every crime defined in the statute, even where it is not expressly mentioned as an essential element, has been discussed in a number of cases. R versus Prince and Queen versus Tolson are the two most important cases on this point. In the case of R versus Prince, Prince Henry was tried for having unlawfully taken away an unmarried girl below the age of 16 years out of the lawful custody and against the will of her father, under the belief that she was 18 years old. Jury found that before the accused took her away, the girl had told him that she has attained the age of 18 years. It was held that the accused's belief about the age of the girl was no defense. It was argued that the statute did not insist on this knowledge of the accused. The doctrine of mens rea should nevertheless be applied and conviction be set aside in the absence of criminal intention. 16 judges tried the case and all but one unanimously held Prince liable. By a majority of 15 to 1, the court held that a mistaken belief, even though based on reasonable grounds that the girl was over 16 years of age, is no defense to a charge of kidnapping. A statutory offense of taking a girl under 16 years of age out of possession and against the will of her father. A distinction was drawn between the acts that were in themselves innocent but made punishable by the statute, that is called malum prohibitum, and the acts that were intrinsically wrong and immoral, that is malum insi. In the former, a reasonable belief in the existence of the fact that, if true, would take the case out of the mischief of the statute and would be a good defense. But in the latter case, such a belief was immaterial unless, of course, the law made it otherwise. In these offenses, which are malum insi, mens rea is presumed and it need not to be proved specifically. Justice Brett, who gave a dissenting opinion, was of the view that in order to constitute an offence, mens rea is an essential element and it was necessary to the prosecution to establish mens rea on the part of the accused. Three theories were propounded in this case. First, Justice Brett propounded that in order to constitute a crime, mens rea is an essential element. Second, Justice Denman held that the liability was based on the ground that the accused knowingly committed a civil wrong by taking a minor girl from the lawful custody of her parents. And third, Justice Bramwell held that it was sufficient to establish that Prince had intended to commit an immoral act. The real reason, as has been stated above, for the conviction was that the accused had committed an act which was forbidden by the statute. In the case of Queen versus Tolson, the court held that a reasonable belief in good faith in the death of first spouse negatives mens rea and is a good defense to a charge of bigamy. In this case, the marriage of the accused, that is Mrs. Tolson, to Mr. Tolson took place in 1880, and Mr. Tolson deserted her on December 13, 1881. She and her father made inquiries about him and ultimately came to know that he had been lost in a vessel bound for America, which went down with all hands on board. On January 10, 1887, the accused, supposing herself to be widow, went through a ceremony of marriage with another man. The circumstances were well known to the second husband, and the ceremony was in no way was concealed. In December 1887, Mr. Tolson suddenly reappeared. Upon these facts, Mrs. Tolson was charged of bigamy under Section 57 of the Offences Against Persons Act 1861. In the trial court, she was convicted, and then she filed the appeal before the higher court. The question before the Court of Appeal was whether Mrs. Tolson had guilty intention in committing the offence of bigamy. The court, by majority, set aside the conviction on the ground that a bona fide belief about the death of first husband at the time of second marriage is a good defense. The court also laid down that the doctrine of mens rea would be applied in statutory offenses also, unless the same is ruled out by the statute. In this case, the accused acted in good faith upon reasonable and probable cause of belief without rashness or negligence. Therefore, she is not to be considered guilty, as she was found to be mistaken. In the case of R versus Wheat and Stocks, Wheat, a man of little education, instructed his solicitor to obtain divorce from his first wife and received a telegram from them that he would shortly receive the necessary papers for signatures. He thereupon married Stocks, and at his trial for bigamy, the jury found that he believed on reasonable ground and in good faith that he had been divorced from his first wife. He was nevertheless convicted, and his conviction was affirmed on appeal. The Court of Criminal Appeal held that there was no sufficient evidence that Weed has reasonable grounds for believing that he had been divorced. But the judgment proceeds to declare in general terms that a reasonable belief that his first marriage has been dissolved is no defense to the charge of bigamy. It is submitted that the two cases are perfectly reconcilable. In Tolson's case, the accused's mistake was one of fact, and in Wheat's case, the accused's mistake was mistake of law, and therefore he was guilty of an offense. Mrs. Tolson did not intend to do the act forbidden by the statute, that is to marry another man, whereas Wheat did. In the case of Brand versus Wood, it was finally held that the principle of mens rea is applicable not only to common law offences but also to statutory offences. It was held by Lord Goddard that the general rule applicable to criminal cases is actus non facit reum nisi mens sit rea. It is of utmost importance for the protection of liberty of subject that a court should always bear in mind that unless a statute, either expressly or by necessary implications, rules out mens rea as a constituent part of the crime, the court should not find a man guilty of an offence against the criminal law unless he has a guilty mind. Now we come to the fourth module, that is mens rea and Indian Penal Code. J.D. Maini, Ratanlal Dheerajlal and various other authors have taken the view that the common law doctrine of mens rea has no general application in India. Maini observed that under Indian Penal Code, such a doctrine of mens rea is wholly out of place. Every offence is defined and the definition states not only what the accused must have done, but the state of his mind with regard to that act when he was doing it. The word mens rea has nowhere been used in the Indian Penal Code, but it has been applied in the following two ways. First, while defining offences, words used indicate actual criminal intent required for the offence. The expressions fraudulently, dishonestly, voluntarily, knowingly and intentionally, etc., used in the definitions indicate the criminal intent. No such words have, however, been used in the cases which cannot be committed by an innocent person. In those offences, criminal intent is presumed. Such offences are waging war against the government under section 121, sedition under section 124A and counterfeiting coins under section 232, etc. Second, the IPC contains a separate chapter of general exceptions, beginning from section 76 to section 106, which indicate the circumstances where the absence of criminal intent is presumed. This is negative method of applying the principle of mens rea in the Indian Penal Code. Thus, though the word mens rea as such is nowhere found in the IPC, its essence is reflected in almost all the provisions of the Indian Penal Code. Every offence created under IPC virtually imports the idea of criminal intent or mens rea in some form or the other. The doctrine of mens rea has been applied by the courts in India, and it is now formally settled law that mens rea is an essential ingredient of offences. In the case of R. Hariprasad Rao versus State, the Supreme Court ruled that unless a statute either expressly or by necessary implications rules out mens rea as a constituent element of crime, a person should not be found guilty of an offence unless he had a guilty mind at the time of commission of the offence. The Apex Court reiterated the same principle in the case of State of Maharashtra versus M.H. George. This question was once again agitated before the Supreme Court in the case of Nathulal versus State of MP. In this case, the accused, a food grain dealer, applied for a license and deposited the requisite license fee. He, without the knowledge of rejection of his application, purchased food grains and sent returns to the licensing authority, who on checking found that it was in excess of the quantity permitted by section 7 of the Food Grains Dealers Licensing Orders 1958. The accused was prosecuted but acquitted on the ground that he had no guilty mind. The Supreme Court observed that the accused was under a bona fide impression that license in regard to which he had made an application was issued to him, though not actually sent to him. The fact that the licensing authority did not communicate to him the rejection of his application confirmed the accused's belief. It was on that belief that he stored the food grains and was sending returns to the concerned authorities. He could not, therefore, be said to have intentionally contravened the provisions of the statute. Now we come to the fifth module, that is exceptions to the principle of mens rea. There are certain exceptional cases in which mens rea is not required to be proved. These exceptions are, first, offences which are made as such by the statute. For example, the offence of waging war against the state or the offence of kidnapping. Second, all offences relating to public nuisance, private libel and contempt of court. Third, offences against the welfare of public, that is social welfare offences. In these offences, the principle of strict liability is followed. For example, offences under the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act 1954 or the Protection of Civil Rights Act 1955. Fourth exception is the cases in which, although the proceeding is criminal in form, but it is only a summary mode of enforcing a civil right. Now, we come to the sixth module, that is actus reus. It is the third essential element of crime. A human being and evil intent are not enough to constitute a crime, for you cannot know the intentions of a man. The thought of a man is not triable. The criminal intent, in order to be punishable, must become manifest in some voluntary act or omission. In other words, some overt act or illegal omission must take place in pursuance of the guilty intention. Actus reus is commonly defined as a criminal act that was the result of voluntary body movement. This describes a physical activity that harms another person or damages property. Anything from a physical assault or murder to the destruction of public property would qualify as an actus reus. Professor Kenny defined the term actus reus as such result of human conduct as the law seeks to prevent. The act done or omitted must be an act forbidden or commanded by some law. Russell calls actus reus as the physical result of human conduct. When criminal policy regards such act as sufficiently harmful, the commission of the act is prohibited on the pain of punishment. Omission as an act of criminal negligence is another form of actus reus. In other words, an act includes illegal omissions also. A man is held liable if some duty is cast upon him by law and he omits to discharge that duty. Now, we come to the last module, that is conclusion. At the end, we can say that physical element, that is actus reus, and mental element, that is mens rea, are the two tests of criminality known to our legal system, which is based on English law. It is the fundamental principle of criminal liability that there must be a wrongful act, that is actus reus, combined with a wrongful intention, that is mens rea. A person cannot be punished only for his act in the absence of guilty intention on his part. Now, the principle of mens rea is a settled law and is applied in case of almost of all the offenses. With all this information, here we come to the end of today's lecture. Do keep in mind what we discussed today. It's time for you all to do some self-study. This is Dr. Vikas Agrawal signing off. If you want to learn more and enhance your knowledge, you may log on to our website for MCQs, quizzes and LORs, that is www.cec.nic.in. Till then, goodbye.